You are welcome to the broadcast of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International. In this broadcast, join International Crusade and Conference Speaker, Teacher, Senior Pastor, Apostle, General Overseer and Presiding Prelate of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International, Bishop Akintayo Samjoli.
I announce to you, whatever was to follow you, that is not from God, it will not follow you, it will not follow your children.
His teachings and ministries have brought deliverance and transformation to many lives and families across the nation and beyond. Receive God's word with faith in your heart and watch your life move from glory to glory.
Hallelujah. Good morning and you welcome once again to another time in God's presence. And I trust that the word of God is going to help you greatly. And I want to encourage you to get someone else to be a part and to tune in this morning on Facebook, on YouTube, on and be a part. And so don't forget to subscribe if you're on YouTube, like Facebook, etc., etc., and be a part of what is going on. This morning, I want to briefly speak on being militant as Christians. Let's open the Bible to 2 Timothy 2, verse 3 and 4. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 and verse 4. It says, "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier." Paul was given Timothy and given Christians a great advice. And this was actually the Spirit of God speaking to the church of God. And not just in those days, but in all ages. And I should say this word is particularly for us in this day and age. Paul was speaking to Timothy by the Spirit of God, therefore, as a spiritual son, okay, was a father to Timothy. In verse 1, he says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same coming down to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." And then he comes to him and speaks to him, "Endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." This was a time in Timothy's life and ministry that things had taken a downward turn. His church, had been reduced in size, in number. Many had deserted him, deserted the faith. He was having pressure from government, pressure from various places, right? His teachings had been presented to the authorities that be, and he was in great disfavor with many, and his own people, his own members that he had raised and that had given him a healthy church, that made Paul write the first book of Timothy, instructing him how to appoint elders, etc., etc. The church that was doing well had been depleted, and Timothy had given up on ministry, that the thing is not working. People had forsaken him, things had gone down, but Paul encourages him in chapter 1, and then comes over to chapter 2 and continues now to show him the way forward. And he says to him as a son, be strong, okay, in the grace that's in Christ Jesus. But then he goes on to tell him also to look out for faithful men, change your approach to ministry, Don't just pick up people, all right? But then look for faithful men, men whom you have proved. And then he now tells them a very important instruction for us all, that endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. As we look around, this is an instruction that many of us need to come back to and be aware of, that we must endure hardness. Many people cannot endure any form of hardness. Many people rebel against any difficult situation, turn their backs on God, turn their backs on spiritual authority, and have, you know, this idea that things, and, you know, it mainly maybe emanates from our own perception of life, but also from what is coming from ministry, all right? That we are not prepared for hardness. We are looking out for ease in every area of life. And the slightest challenge that comes away suggests to us that God is not with us and we are not people of faith, but we fail to realize that we're in combat zone. We're in a place of war. We're in a place of battle. We fail to realize what we've been called to do and what we are doing. We're supposed to be doing. We're engaged in a war. A war has been declared on us by the enemy. Look at what is happening in countries where war has been brought to them. Those who have responded to the challenge are able to resist the enemy. They're those that just, you know, like, well, what is this? And why are we going through this? And they cannot stand the challenges of life and ministry, or of realities of life, of the situation. Now, the Bible says that no man that warreth entangleth himself with the fears of this life. And this is an instruction to believers. It is saying, have a militant attitude. Be a militant Christian. The word militant there means a battle-ready Christian. It means a confrontational Christian. It means an aggressive Christian. What does it mean? Are you going to go around fighting with people? The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Okay, Ephesians 6 verse 12. So it tells you you're involved in a close combat, but it's not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places. But then we are aware that the enemy expresses himself also through people. The attacks that come directly. Things can just happen. Accidents, issues with health, and issues to dreams, different situations. But a good deal of the enemy's battle expressed through people. And so you must have a mindset that you're warring against spiritual powers, but you're also alert for the battle that comes through individuals. And some people right now are in trouble at the place of work because of a person that was used to create a situation. The person is not a direct enemy, but he has become a channel. That's why Christ turned and rebuked Peter and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." Christ was very militant, was very alert to warfare, alert to battle, alert to what is going on around him. He didn't just accept things. You have got to have a mindset that is ready, alert, sharp to pick up what is going on around you, sharp to identify battles, situations, raised up. You could be able to identify whose voice is that in that person speaking. Is it the person's voice or is it Satan's voice being expressed? What is this going on? You must understand that we are prepared for hardness, or we should be prepared for hardness, and we should be prepared for war at all points in time. When Christ Jesus told his disciples, when he said to Peter in Matthew 16, verse 18, and to the church, he says, "And I said to thou art Peter, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall prevail against it." We've made it known very well that he referred to Peter as a small rock. And then he said, upon this huge rock. So contrary to what has been taught throughout history, that Peter is a rock upon which the church is built, Peter was not the rock upon which the church was built. Okay, the church itself, Jesus Christ, is the chief cornerstone and is built upon the foundations that the apostles laid. All right? And but Jesus Christ himself is the chief cornerstone. He's the rock upon which the church is built. Now, but then he brings out a major truth to us here, that there's a battle going on. There's a battle that we're born into the midst of battle. And he says that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So long as you're part of the church, you must realize that there's a battle going on. And you have got to be militant. You've got to be alert. And you've got to be ready for hardship and for hardness. You've got to be ready to go through difficult situations. You've got to be ready to fight. You've got to be ready to be opposed, to be rejected, to be despised. Paul says we've learned to abase. We've learned to abound. We've learned to be in hunger. We've learned to go through whatever we have to face in this battle. In 1 Peter 5, verse 8, he says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. The Bible did not say you are without enemies. Number one, it tells you that the gates of hell are fighting against the church. Now, in this verse, it says your adversary. It didn't say your neighbor's adversary. It didn't say your pastor's adversary. It didn't say the adversary of the church. It said your adversary. So if you are, casual, naive, complacent, deceived enough to think that you do not have an adversary, you do not have an enemy, you've made a sad mistake. And your enemy, you must understand, is not just some little powers somewhere in some corner. It says it is the devil himself. The devil is the enemy of every child of God. And the devil now went on to engage demonic powers to also come in and be your enemies. And he walks through them. And additionally, he adds human beings. So you have got to be alert that you're in a grievous battle. The word adversary comes from a Greek word, which means an opponent. And interestingly, it means Satan himself. And it refers to the arch enemy. Okay? Now, but what is also interesting in this particular name used for the devil, the adversary, it points to an opponent in law. Somebody, for example, who sues you. Someone who takes you to court. Someone takes an action against you. And even though you may not be guilty of it. So you must understand that when you talk about the militant church, you're also very conscious of your actions to leave no scope to the enemy. To leave no scope to the enemy to have something to use against you. Your prayerlessness, your compromise with sin, your involvement in the flesh. You've got to make sure the enemy has no way to attack you and to afflict you. You must give him nothing to use against you. Look at this verse in 1 Timothy 5 verse 14. It says, I will therefore the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give not occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. So when you look at the last phrase of that verse, it clearly brings you to understand that it's not just, an attack against your health and just coming directly, or people being stirred up against you, to conspire against you, to fight against your job, but something also can give them access. So the Bible says, give none occasion. Don't give any chance. Don't leave something open for the enemy, for the adversary to speak reproachfully. about you. Don't give chance. Don't fail in the things you're supposed to do. Don't falter in the things that are required of you. And so give the enemy opportunity to make mockery of you and to speak evil of you or to have, you know, a legal cause against you to say, yes, you did so and you did that. Therefore, you deserve this. Inasmuch as the blood of Jesus Christ speaks for us, the Bible calls you to be on guard. So when you speak of people going to war, it's not just to open fire and to shoot at an enemy. Okay, I have not seen this, but I remember somebody expressing, somebody preacher, trying to bring out reality that was shown in the film. But I'm saying to you, besides film, this has happened in real life. And they're showing it from a real life point of view. Where, for instance, there are some soldiers at the battlefront and they commanded to just lie in wait. And one soldier, one careless soldier who thought that the enemies were far away because they've had nothing, they saw no movement, decided to just have a smoke and lit a cigarette. And that was the end, because the enemy was very close to them. And but they could not locate where they were. But when once a soldier decided to light a cigarette, that was it. They came under fire and many of them were slaughtered. Just one ill comportment. I remember some account of some people somewhere, some soldiers, who declared the same terrain as far as they were concerned. And they pushed back rebels. And they now got engaged in mining. They got to a place they found, wow, look at this, and put down their weapons. And that was it. While they were digging and doing things, they were surrounded and slaughtered. Their guns were taken and their attention was so much, and we have found them, or we found a place that has sensors. So, and those that knew the area knew whatever, said, ah, come on, quickly. And not one of them survived. And that soldier was telling of the, you know, a time when some soldiers had some problems with the eyesight and, you know, got blind and this and that. And people were saying, okay, what happened? They gave all kinds of stories. But a soldier, a Christian soldier, who was there, who understood what happened, working in the area, now was narrating later on. He said, let me tell you what actually happened. The soldiers, when once they cleared this area, went on the looting spree. And they did not know that these, what do you call it, rebels, had put some acid, some kind of poison in palm oil. And the bus, and they now cleared and took their families. And that's how people died in distant places from what they took home. You see, you must understand that you've got to be alert. You've got to be sharp. Face the fact that you're involved, you're engaged in warfare. You cannot afford to let down your guard in any single way. You've got to realize the enemy is looking for just a loophole. The Bible says, give none occasion. He's looking for an occasion to attack you. An occasion of prayerlessness, an occasion of slackness, an occasion of sin, an occasion of immorality, an occasion of lying. He's just looking for an open door to use, to smite you. You cannot be caught off guard. You cannot be caught, you know, in slackness, being on alert to what is going on around you. And the things that you need to address. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today, pay attention to this word. I'm going to read also from 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14 to 16. It says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship? 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? The word of God is drawing our attention. Do not be slack. Do not be engaged with the world, with the fears of this life. It says, what fellowship is light with darkness? righteousness with unrighteousness. What communion? What is there? Why are you getting yourself involved in those things? And we'll see people. Verse 15. What concord has Christ with Belial? What part has he that believeth with an infidel? Why are you engaging yourself with people that are not genuine? People that don't know Christ. You're distracting yourself, using your time with them. Yes, you have to interact with them in the world. But what is the friendship about? All your study mates, you don't seek for believers. All your friends in school, all your friends at work, they are going to pollute and contaminate you. I know of Christians who've lost great grounds and entered into great trouble because of who they chose their friends and what they're engaged in. Today, I pray that God will help us to get more aware of the battle that surrounds us, and that we'll respond accordingly, and that we'll make choice of friendship, choice of activities. Remember, choice of friendship, choice of activities, choice of the right use of your time, choice of the right use of your resources. You must never forget this. As a soldier, a good soldier, the Bible says, must be a good soldier. Make choice about the use of your time. Make choices, right choice about your friendship. Make choices about the use of your resources. Make important choices about your friendship and your acquaintances. Be a militant Christian.
I believe you've been tremendously blessed by this program with such powerful exposition of God's Word. Join the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International in our next broadcast. Also join us in worship at the Faith Cathedral, 5 and 7 Victoria Street in Freetown, on Sundays at 7 and 9 a.m. and Thursdays at 6 p.m. For prayers, counseling and testimony, please call +232 30 90 007 or +232 77 853 207 or +232 77 858 1. This is the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International.